Well, howdy, 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 folks. I am getting everything in here, and we're going to wait because there's over 400 people apparently trying to get in. And we found out at the last minute that we had let me turn this off. Let us go over here. Okay. Good grief. Okay. So people are – it's letting people in. So – we're going to wait till everybody gets in. It's up to 106 right now. And hopefully everybody can hear me. Jason, can you hear me? I can hear you. Can you hear me?
Yeah, you got to turn on my video. Won't let me turn it on.
Really? Yeah. All right.
I can hear you.
And
there we go. Should be coming on now.
All right. There's Michael Wood up there.
How come I don't have no video?
Look, Terry Warren here. Todd's here. Everybody's here. Chat's running good. Good. Richard Coleman.
That's for everybody's safety.
Carolina's here. Hopefully you can see us. Look at him.
Drink it. Hey. Oh.
Look at my
hat. You know, there should be a warning to come up before you open that camera up, Michael.
I know. It should be a warning. Of course, we could do screenshots and sell the pictures.
Yeah, you put them down in the baseboard in the basement to keep the rats out.
All right. And we still got people coming in. It's up over 100 now. And, well, it was already over 100, but there's still people. It's funneling them in. I had a delay because right as I went to do it, it said, you have – over 400 people wait in the waiting room, and my account only allowed for 100 on webinars, which we had never done a webinar through here. We had already done the private meetings, and the private meeting was set to 1,000. So I had to upgrade the plan, and then my freaking credit card had expired in December, so I had to punch in all that crap, and customer service was helping me, but I'm glad we got in. And Jason, what you'll have to do is find an attendee and make them a presenter. You can do that, from the more button. Okay. Let me,
yeah, we're 120 and climbing.
And we've got, Orlando's here. Tom's here. They got questions. You're probably better off typing in your question, and I can pull up questions. And then later we'll get to those. I'm going to wait just a little bit longer, but I'm going to tell you a story, okay? I'm going to tell you a story for those people that got in here quick, okay? It's still running up. The number's still running up, but apparently it funnels them in. I don't know how that works, but I've never done it this way. How's the sound and everything, Jason?
It's good. Volumes are good.
Yeah.
I think we still got Michael muted, right?
Yeah. My Ariel, I hear you, Piper Dogs. Yeah, it is different, and I'll tell you why in a minute, okay? I'll tell you why we did this. Craig, thank you for that. I'm glad it's sounding good. Illinois says it sounds good. Dang, y'all are awesome, telling me it's sounding good. Hiccuping Dragon is here. Awesome. That's from Craig. Okay, Paul's in the house. Paul Browning in the house. Love you, brother. All right, so here we go. I want to tell you something real quick before we get started, and then we'll move on to other stuff. I got a lot to cover. I mean, this is going to be awesome. We're going to have fun. I hope you're excited. Hope you drink your bourbon. I know I did, but not enough to slur. Okay. No slurring. I do have a lisp, but that is normal. There's Jason with his whatever. I don't even know if it's legal. So here we go. We're gonna cover a bunch of stuff, but, what I want to tell you about in 1955. Okay. In 1955, a man turned 65 years old. That means he was born in 1890, okay? And this man was living. He was pretty much overworking. He's, you know, 65 years old and a rough life, went through the Depression, has a unbelievable story, and I'm not going to go through all that. We don't have enough time. But this man, in 1955, 65 years old, is on $95 of Social Security. That's what he got paid, okay? And I've known this story for years, and you may have heard it, okay? And if you have, it'll just give you chill bumps again, because I love this freaking story. And at 65 years old, he's getting 95 Social Security, has no job, but he has a recipe. He has a recipe that he thinks is the bomb. And he goes to different restaurants, because he can't afford nothing, and tries to get restaurants to take his recipe for free and give him a profit from anything they sell. And according to his words and his family's words, he went to 1,000 different restaurants. Okay. So he went outside of his own area and he went all over the place in multiple states around him, trying to get rid of a recipe that he believed to be the best recipe on the planet for this particular item. And he tried to give it away and just do profit sharing. If you do good with it, we both make money. It's a good deal. Nobody would take his freaking recipe. Nobody. And so he's like, piss. And he kept going. He got to 1,009, his 1,009th restaurant. Okay. And this is where I get chill bumps. I don't know if you can see the hair standing up on my arm, but I love this freaking story. And 1,009, that man said, yeah, I'll do that with you. And that was the start, the genesis that started Kentucky Fried Chicken. Colonel Sanders, Kentucky Fried Chicken recipe. 1,009, 1,008 no's to get there. And it reminded me of something. We've all gotten no's, and some of us get kicked in the groin and get kicked in the head, and it knocks us down and we feel like crap. And y'all all know you all have a story. I promise you have a story. It reminds me, there's a story about a boy. He's 24 years old, but he's sitting on a bus with his dad, and he's looking out the window of the bus at 24. And he's going, oh my gosh, Dad, look at the clouds roll by. And his dad's like, yeah, son, isn't that cool? And he goes, it looks like they're chasing us. And this couple sitting across from them in the aisle on the bus says, you might want to get your son checked out, because he's 24. And he's amazed that the clouds are following him. And the dad says, he just came from the doctor. He was born blind, and this is the first time he's ever been outside with his new corneas. He's able to see for the first time in his life clouds. And it made me, you know, it reminded me of the, and I've heard that story before, but it ties in together, because it makes you go, don't judge, because everybody's got a story. Don't judge a book by its cover. Don't judge because you think you know something, because you see a 24-year-old staring at the clouds, being amazed and in awe of the clouds, and you go, what an idiot. He must be a retard, or something's wrong with him. No, there was nothing wrong with him. Everything was right with him. It was because you didn't know all the facts, or we didn't know all the facts. And that's how life is. And every one of us has stories. But I want you to know, with the KFC story tied into that, is that we don't know his story. We don't know what it took for him to go out 1,008 times before going out the 1,009th and getting it. There's a lot of times we put limitations on ourselves as if there isn't enough limitations from others, okay? We get limitations put on us by the naysayers. Y'all have seen me write about naysayers and do videos about naysayers, and and those kinds of things. And there's a this will be the last story I tell you unless I think of another one. There's a guy that goes to another country. I think it was Africa or something. And I may butcher this story up, but you'll get the point. You'll get the message. And he's watching these guys use elephants to pick up huge logs and stuff. And he's going, how is he keeping these freaking massive animals? How do they keep them from going anywhere? And he looks down and he sees this little tiny rope made out of straw, like old timey rope, but it ain't even as big around as your pinky finger. And these guys are managing these elephants with this little tiny piece of twine. And he asked them, he said, how in the world are you keeping these freaking elephants from just busting through the twine? Cause Lord knows they can bust through the twine. And the one man, the guy that was on their tour guide, talked to the leader or whatever of the foreman of this little work group that doing these log moving. And he said, when these elephants are born, they tie a string around them to hold them, keep them back. And they tie it to one leg and it stops the baby elephants. And the baby elephant thinks for the rest of its life that that string is going to stop him. So he never tries to pull against it. And the moral of that story, if you didn't already catch it, is the fact that we often have limitations that we put on ourselves. Forget the naysayers. Forget all the people that have negative crap to say. But we often forget that we have put limitations on ourselves that have prevented us from breaking that string and going our own way. And those elephants, if they had the consciousness to think like we do, they'd go, that string ain't gonna hold me. I'm, 11 million pounds. And that string's got a tensile strength, maybe a 6. And they leave. And a lot of times we put our own self-limitations on that prevent us from having success. It's part of what this group's about. It's part of what Vendors United is about, is telling our problems, sharing our stuff. I got a message today from a vendor in the group. I'm not going to mention his name, but he said he, and I could read this, I guess, and because it'd probably be helpful. Let me see if I can find this real quick. Listen to this, and I hope this doesn't bother him that I'd read this, but I'm not going to say any names. Thank you for a safe place to discuss my many questions. In my town, I'm trying to keep my business under wraps until I get the go-ahead from the health department. I'd hate to tell everyone, and then all of my plans fall flat on their face. Talk about embarrassing. Having VU has allowed me to chat and ask questions about that leaking public concerning my new business. I just wanted to tell you thanks for the safe haven. That says a lot, and I hope that you see the value in that as well. Now, tonight, I want you to know something. We've invited other people in here, so this ain't our safe haven tonight, okay? Anybody in the world that wanted to come in could come in tonight and watch the show and maybe take something home that changes their life or helps their business or helps them in some way. And we got a lot to cover. Let me tell you what we got going tonight. Already... let me do this first, Jason, before I do that. Did you find any of the ones like the Corey's and Diz's and Mark Lawler's and anybody else that wants to be up here on the screen?
I can probably pull Corey in.
Well, it doesn't matter if they don't want to be on there right now. It doesn't matter to me. I just didn't want them to think we were leaving them out.
Corey's there. I believe Mark's there. He was having a hard time getting in. I think we're just somebody in that, it's getting a little crazy, but let me see here. Yeah, Corey's in there. All right, Corey, you should be coming up. Trying to find Mark.
All right, while you do that, I'm going to go through what we're going to cover tonight so I can kind of bait everybody to stay, okay? There's nothing for sale, okay? So we're gonna, I'm gonna ask a few people, if possible, to come in, and I'll make you a panelist, basically, and you'll be on the screen. Unless you don't want to be on the screen, you can leave your video off and just go audio only. But I'd like for you to share your worst day of vending, your worst day, and what you learned, okay? Because a lot of people think that they see Jason, or they see Michael, or they see Mark Lawler, and or Billy, and they go, dang, them guys just got lucky. No, we've had some bad days. I can tell you, Jason's called me crying, and I've had to go, you know, give him a bottle and put him to bed, because he's had some horrible days. Corey's had bad
some
days.
Days you're a bird, some days you're a windshield.
Right, right. So, so you can share either your worst day or your biggest mistake so far, if you would. It would kind of personalize the fact that no matter how good you get, you still screw up sometimes. And sometimes the bad days ain't even your fault. But I'm going to talk tonight about new signs and banners coming your way. And I may not even go into much into it, but there are new signs and banners for VU members coming that are so freaking cheap that you're going to go, what? For the same quality, you're going to get stuff because VU and a good friend of ours and a VU member who is a vendor as well, who also owns a side business, is going to be doing stuff where you can get 3 and 4 banners for the price you've been paying for one. All right? So, do what?
Bring in more to tell you about his work.
I didn't hear anything you said.
Bring in Ed Forbes. He wants to tell you about his work today.
Okay. Just give me just a minute. Let me go through the rest of what we're covering tonight. We've got new sponsors coming to VU. That'll be coming soon, announced in the group privately. You'll get emails. You know me and emails. I'll send you plenty of them. Okay. We've got a lemonade smasher coming. We got concession sink, sink kits, insurance, kettle corn. And I want to tell you about my new shiny object. Okay. My new shiny object. If you haven't been following my emails, you need to get on that bandwagon. I get spun up. I'm like a, you know, the squirrel deal where ADD, ADHD, I don't know what I have, but I'm definitely an entrepreneur. I have learned to not shoot as many times before I start aiming. But I did order a kettle corn machine, and it's on its way. And I got that from kettlecornmachines.com, and we've got a special offer from them tonight. I'll tell you about that in a little bit. But it's only for two people. But you get to pick who you are, okay? We won't even do a vote. We won't do a count. We won't do a random number. You get to determine if you're the winner of that, but you're going to need to remind me. Jason, please remind me about that tonight.
We got to do that thing for kettle corn.
That's that. Thank you. Now I'm reminded. Okay. Three musts this year. Three musts, okay? And these are important. These are three musts if you're in business or going to get in business this year. Start off right. Make a commitment this year that you are going to do catering in some way, shape, form, or fashion. If you don't know what that is or what different types of shapes and forms and fashions that entails, please, please go to learnhotdogs.com and just type in the word catering. Or if you're a VU member, you'll find even more in the VU group. And a lot of help and a lot of forms and a lot of other stuff. But I also want you to make me a promise that you will keep good records, okay? You don't have to keep accountant type records, but you need to keep a few major things and keep up with those things. If you don't know what those are, I did a free video at learnhotdogs.com. If you just type in records or record keeping, you will find it on learnhotdogs.com. And it will give you everything to do, how to, I draw it out for you on a yellow pad. So it's simple to keep. It will change your business life. I promise you, it will change everything. I don't care if you never do nothing else but keep good records. I promise you'll make more money this year all because of that record keeping. Also, the third thing, and this should be easy, but it's typically the hardest for most people. And Jason can vouch on this. Michael Wood can vouch on this. And I guarantee you Mark Lawler and the rest of them that have been around in the group for a long time, they know that this is the hard one, is an open mind. Because what happens And I don't want you to open your mind so far that your brain falls out. I want you to open it far enough, though, to take some advice, to listen to what the pros are telling you. You may not always agree with everything. You may not always go, you know what, this is not up my alley, but I'm willing to do this, or I'm going to do a variation of it. It may not even be comfortable. But what you've got to do is keep an open mind, because some of the things that are told are going to change your business. We had a vendor on recently who said, I screwed up last year because I should have listened to y'all on this and this and this. I would have made this much more money had I done these things. I'll never do that again. We get that. But what's cool is he had his open mind enough to look at it and to go back and go, yeah, I should have done that. It wasn't comfortable at the moment, but now I see why I should have done that. And sometimes that comes down, for me, it was pricing. It took a long time. I was still vending when Jason told me, you need to change your damn pricing, boy. And because my pricing sucked, okay? And I was uncomfortable. And I didn't have enough mind to do it. Eventually I changed. And I was rewarded handsomely for it. You can too. And it's not just about pricing, but it's about everything in business. You may be going, I don't know what the importance is of having dang a good looking sign or spending $300 on better graphics on my food trailer or my food cart when I already got customers. Well, if it doubled your freaking numbers, if you started getting catering gigs because you looked more professional, would it help? Could you get $7 for what you've been selling for $5? All those things play a part. I just want you to keep an open mind so that you can move forward with those things in your business, because we're all here to help each other. Nobody's here to badmouth you, beat you down, hurt you. We don't care about, you know, the time you ran over your neighbor's cat. We don't care about how many times you've been married. All we care about is who you are today and where you're going and how can we help you get there. And what advice and tips will you learn that you can share back with us or someone else that helps us grow and become better at what we do? That's what it's about. So now, that's the three things you must do this year. Okay, I want a commitment. Sign, blood, writing, whatever you got to do. Press hard 3 copies. Okay, the lifetime membership to VU. I know it's dirt cheap, okay? It's going up, okay? It was $9.97. We put it for $4.97. It was supposed to go up January 1st. It didn't. They didn't get the page done. It is going up, but they did add something cool to it. It ain't up yet, but it's fixing to go up, and they added a payment plan. You can do a payment plan with it. I thought that was pretty cool. I was told to mention that to you tonight. Payment plan on VU, on the lifetime. Then you're done. And don't join that unless you're ready. Okay. Don't feel like pressure to do that. All right. Tonight I'm going to, you know what? I'm going to go ahead and do this real quick. Are you at the top of Google? If you're not at the top of Google, then something's wrong, because nobody in your space is probably fighting for it and you could easily have it. So if you're a VU member, I sent out an email and I said, here's where to go get it. It's in your VU dashboard. If you go to Vendors United, go to the bottom of the courses and free stuff, grab that freaking course. It's free right now, 100%. It's 99 pages long, I believe, 98 pages long. It's long. It make your eyes bleed reading it. Okay? But if you'll apply that stuff, let me give you a good example. Alex Steele, y'all know him, Frankenstein's. He said, here's a snapshot of my Google. He wasn't even on it. Today, I'm going to apply these things, but I'm only going to do the, you know, quick and sweet, easy, right? Which is what it is. It's quick, sweet, and easy. Today, I contacted Alex and said, congratulations, brother. You're at the top of Google. I mean, it's him. And so that's just in a, you know, literally a couple days. So I thought that was neat. So you can grab that in there. Nobody's getting that stock, those spots. And Google is important and powerful in your business, especially if you agreed in blood a minute ago to do one of the three things I said, not one of them, but all three of them, but one of them is catering. And it's going to be a huge value and asset to you for getting private gigs. And I ain't talking about going and setting up fancy tables at a wedding. I'm talking about catering, like the mayor calls you and goes, hey, Ben, can you come? My daughter is doing this graduation party at the Douglas Dam Lake at the Southport entrance. Could you come feed all them youngins and do all that stuff this weekend? And you get this private gig and make $700. By the way, I did that. So that's stuff you can do. Now, Jason has another thing you can do, and this goes for anybody, okay? Jason, I'd love for you to share this in just a second, okay? I got two more things, and then I want you to share what they need to do if they took the winter off and what they're doing if they're bored this winter, okay? Now, I want you to write this down, folks. Robo Killer. This is just a handy tip because I like it, okay? RoboKiller.com. I'm not affiliated or anything with them. I heard about it, and I tried it, and it's already working. It's pretty cool. When you know those crappy calls you get where it's automated and it's somebody selling you, they're telling you your car warranty expired. My car, my truck, my Toyota truck is a 2003. Of course, my warranty's expired. It ain't about to expire. It expired about 15 years ago. Okay. And they're trying to sell me a warranty or whatever, or selling me dental plan or whatever. Well, this freaking robo killer grabs any of those calls that has over 1.5 million numbers already in its database. And it prank calls them back. It prank talks to them. And you can listen to some of them, and it keeps it for you. So today I listened to one that it pranked on a DirecTV robocall I got. It was freaking hilarious. It said, hold on. You'll have to – hold on. I didn't realize that's who you wanted. We've had problems with the phone lines. Give me just a second. I'll transfer it over. And then it goes through music and – until they hang up. One call stayed on for 43 minutes. 43 minutes. It just badgers them. It's beautiful. Robo killer. Okay. I interviewed the amazing Judy the other day, okay? Way last year, also about a week ago. And I interviewed Judy. And if y'all don't know Judy, she's got Odell's super duper tacos. Okay. But, she's got Odell's Oki tacos. She's got an awesome system and setup, but she started with kettle corn, and I wanted to know about kettle corn. And so I called her up and said, hey, or I messaged her and said, hey, Judy, do you care to share with me? And I want you to see that video. Cause here's a lady and her husband, they were forced into early retirement. Well, early retirement means you ain't getting a check yet. Okay. And you ain't old enough for Social Security. And because Judy's only like 31 or something. So they needed to make a living. So guess what they did? Kettle corn. Okay. And that brings me to what I was going to have Jason remind me of. Okay. That brings me to this. Oh, and we're going to be giving away a cart soon. Just so you know, but that brings me to this. KettleCornMachine.com. You can go over there, KettleCornMachine.com. If you've not heard of Greg Sweet, you've probably been living under a rock if you're in Vindy, okay? He has a ton of videos. He is the founder of Kettle Corn Machine. He started doing kettle corn, and then he started making machines, and I just ordered one from his daughter the other day. And I'm going to show you my experience with it and how to get it started, and I'm going to try to share my failures and my successes as I do this. And so what I'm going to do is tell you about a deal they are allowing me to offer to you. It's up to $500 off of one of their packages. They've got two packages. One, you're going to get $200 off. The other one, you're going to get $500 off. But it's first come, first serve, first two people that contact them at KettleCornMachine.com. They have a number listed there. You can call the number. You can email them. You can do whatever you want there. But if you're interested in getting a machine, now would be the time to get it because it's a heck of a deal, and I hope you can get it. So they're freaking phenomenal. If you've not been following my emails on that, you need to get on my email list so you can watch this story unfold as I learn the kettle corn business. Of course, I'm learning from the master, Greg Sweet. And Greg has since passed away. And I've been talking with his daughter, and she's an adult, and she runs the sales, and the mom is still there, and the family helps. It's a family-run business. They're good people, and they're based out of Washington State. See, you wouldn't have liked them if I'd have said Washington, D.C. me neither. But they're in Washington State. They're freaking awesome family, and they're awesome people. And if you've watched Greg, you know what kind of people they are. And you can still watch all his videos. If you want to talk about somebody that made you feel good just watching a video on kettle corn, on how to make apple kettle corn, apple caramel kettle corn, or he did jalapenos, and I got excited watching him cut up jalapenos, and he gets so excited cutting up the jalapenos, he just starts throwing in whole jalapenos into the kettle corn as it's popping. It was the craziest thing. It was cool, but his enthusiasm is infectious. So yeah, I think you'll like it. It's a great way to start a business. There's some pros to it, though. Many states fall under ag, no food health department deal, no health inspection, and you can start a kettle corn business like this. There's two states I know of right now where you can start with no license, no business license, no ag license, no nothing, because the ag departments in both those states have deemed it a farm product, and they want to promote farmers. So there's lots of ways to go about it. I just wanted to tell you about that. Kettlecornmachine.com. Now, Jason, tell us about winter, boredom, stuff like that.
All right. Hold on a second here. I'll pull up some pictures. All right. So let me get in the share screen. Hold on a second here. Let's see. So basically, this past weekend, guys, I didn't work because it rained. And Daryl, his wife, and I took that time to go over to a show at the convention center and, take a look at stuff. It was a candy show, right? So it was candy. There was also a gift show. So let me pull this up here. Hold on, share. All right. Can you guys see that picture?
Yep.
Okay. Good. All right, so I went there with the intent of a couple things. Finding a candy distributor, because I hate driving around having to pick up all my stuff. All this stuff over here on the shelf, Airheads, the bottle caps, the push pops up here, Pop Rocks. This company has all that. So now I can place my order. It gets boxed up, drop shipped to my house. So right there, that was worth it all on its own, okay? Let me stop this share and bring up another one. Now, the other thing that I stumbled upon before the candy show opened, we walked into the gift show, which, you know, was in this gigantic convention center, and that was open. So we figured, all right, we got an hour. Let's go in there. Let me bring up this other picture here. So as you guys know, at the ski resort, I do a lot of hot chocolate. Okay. Daryl will tell you, he's been there. He's seen it. It's crazy. It can be anywhere from 150 to 400 and some, you know, hot chocolates. Can you guys see that picture?
Yep.
Wait, okay, there we go. Thank you, sir. So these are just some of the packets they make. I think they make like 30 or something like that. So these were samples. So hazelnuts, s'more, cookies and cream. There's a creme brulee, a white chocolate, truffle blanc, vanilla. I found this company. They're close. I can get this stuff in case. And then we can use it at the ski resort. Now I don't have to use the creamers and, you know, the flavored creamers and stuff we were using before. So it just makes it a little bit easier on me. So those two things, that made the day worth it, right? So we go back into the show, and Daryl and I found another line that, fall, winter, maybe early spring, you run it to about 85 degrees. Let me get over here. Hold on a second. Sure, here we go. Okay, so basically looking at here is one of probably, I don't know, six or seven fudge companies, okay? A couple different ways you can get it. The guy's got three or four different displays that are available. They have these little chunks down here in this lower corner in this purplish box. They have the slabs, which probably take up this whole chute here. Then they have these tubs here, and the tubs here are what I'm going to put on the truck for the ski resort. I've thought about getting the fudge this way, but my problem is I don't have the time to cut it, weigh it, all that crap. These tubs are pre-made with a little fork in them. They're already cut. All I got to do is pop them on the shelf. $9 to $12 is what they're retailing for. Great margins on it. Again, 70, I think it was 70 flavors. I'll have to ask Daryl, 70 flavors in this. They had more in the slabs, but you know, something like this in these containers, easy markup. So I got three major things to help me on a rainy day. And we were in and out in probably under 2 hours. And it was a free show. All I had to do was show business card to register, got our badges, and then we go. Okay. So these are the kind of things you got to be looking around your area for on your off time. There's got to be a convention center near you. There's going to be shows, whether it's a candy show, a gift show, things like that. You know, Daryl was looking around in the gift show for odds and ends he can add on for different events, things like phone cords, chargers, things like that. And he found a guy that has basically like a, almost like that fudge shelf. Comes in a box so he can put it on the counter and there's plugs and adapters and cords. And when he's done, he just takes that box down, puts it away, and off he goes. So there's things like this everywhere. And you guys just need to find stuff like this and take advantage of it. Don't just sit home when it's raining. Try and find something like this that will help you. All right? Does that make sense? Michael's not shaking his head. I think Michael went on a beer run.
It makes sense. Yeah, he turned off his camera so he could go drink, grab more beer or something. There he is.
Well, it's safer on our eyes that way, so it's okay. I think, where's Daryl? Daryl, I brought Daryl in. Oh, Michael's back. I brought Daryl in. Diz, unmute yourself. Give me your thoughts on the show, what you found.
Yeah, Jay. So, yeah, to your point, it was a very good show. We were able to I went to it last year, and I went there this year with nothing more than the intention of maybe just learning a little more of what I can possibly sell on my cart. Again, aside from the hot dogs and all that kind of stuff that we sell, you also want to pull in draw-in items, you know, so whether it's, you know, it's popcorn or it's candy or, you know, you go to some of these fairs and festivals and somebody's lost their charger or, you know, needs a charging cord or something, and you buy those little accessories, and Ben's talked about this in other shows and videos and stuff about add-on items, you know, such as like baseball caps and glasses and so forth. But it could also be candy. It could be fudge. So for instance, to Jason's point, Jason's probably going to buy those portion pack units versus I'm probably going to look at that. They have a 12-inch by 2-foot high display case that I'll be able to put right there on the table and put it right back in the trailer when I'm done. The shelf life on that fudge that he was selling, I think Jason, correct me if I'm wrong, was like 6 months, right? So as long as it's kept well. So again, what's nice about these shows, it does allow you to, you know, to see what else is out there. It does, you know, give you things to do during your free time. If, you know, if you're not vending that particular day or you're only a seasonal vendor or whatnot, use the off season to look at these stuff. But there's going to be things that I'm going to be pulling in from some of these wholesalers that we met with just to, you know, again, nothing more than they're going to be pulling items from my cart. You know, some had 40%, 50%, 60% more, you know, profit lines built in them because the wholesalers on them were so cheap that I can mark them up pretty high and still be able to get what I want for them. And again, not having to buy large quantities, so I'm not stuck with this stuff. If it, number one, doesn't sell, or to Jason's point, I only sell it during seasonal processes when it's a little bit cooler. I mean, certainly when I sell fudge or chocolate-covered pretzels in July and August. But if I could do that during the springtime and fall, great draw-in item. So it's a good time to utilize your downtime. It's a good time to, you know, upgrade the things that you want to do in your cart. But again, to Jason's point, it's just kind of thinking outside the box a little bit. So.
All right. So I like that. And I like the fact that y'all took pictures of it so that we could see what you're talking about. Now, what do you do, Jason? When you shared that with me the other day, I looked in my area and there was nothing. Now I'm talking nothing. The closest place that was doing anything like that was Charlotte, North Carolina, which is a good, you know, 3.5-4 hours away.
Yeah, but see, that's because you don't even live in the sticks. You're past the sticks and the twigs. So, you know, you're going to have to drive a little bit, you know. I mean, you know, at least where there's like, you know, what do you guys call them? Those high rises, you know, things that are two stories tall.
Right.
But, I mean, one of the guys, I think it was an Ariel Piper, put something up. There's a big one in New York. I mean, you can find them basically anywhere there's a convention center. Okay, and I would always maybe check with some of the hotels in town. If there's not a convention center, I would check with them, or also check with your broadline distributor, find out where they put their food show on, and then check with that place. You know, if they say it's, you know, Michael's Hideaway Hotel, well, then you call Michael and, you know, ask him when the candy show is, or if he knows of one. And yeah, you might have to drive, but it can be worth it, just depending on what you're looking at. I mean, Daryl will tell you, like at the ski resort this year, I'm $3 for a can of soda. Okay, I am $5 for a Monster. Candy bars are between $2.50, like candy like that is between $2.50 and $3. Okay, so now you're making money on that. You figured that Hershey bar runs me about 37 cents, 38 cents. I think is what we're getting them for. We're selling that for $3. It's a no-brainer. I mean, Daryl can tell you guys how much candy we go through on a weekend. It's nothing to go through anywhere from $700 to $1,500 in wholesale purchase of candy in a weekend. Those little push pops that look like a lipstick or a chapstick, the kids like, they pull the cap off and they push it up. Yeah, those are $2.50, $3, depending on what kind of mood you catch me in.
We have a company called HT Hackney here that has that kind of stuff. It's more like convenience store goods for dirt cheap. So it's that kind of stuff. And you can even get some of the private label local sellers of fudge and stuff like that. So that may be my option. And I know you can contact them. They're considered a broad line, and you can go to their place and tell them what you're interested in. They'll set you out a little salesman, you know, who sets you out a table of your interests. And you get a bunch of samples and you go home a king and try them out. So you may want to look that up. It's HT Hackney is that distributor. I don't know if they're everywhere, but they're here for sure. Okay, who did we – Jason, we had somebody that was willing to tell about their worst day vending.
Ed Forbes was going to tell you about his worst day vending. I believe it was bike night, he said. You're going to have to bring him in, though.
Let me look for him. Ed, I'm bringing you in. Now you're in.
Hey, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
All right, yeah. So last year, if you're in Pennsylvania, you know it rained the whole summer pretty much. A lot of events were washed out and stuff, but I was able to land one of the spots for bike night, and Jason was there, and Daryl was there as well. The lady was nice enough. She said, "I'm going to put you down by the bikes. You're going to be the only food vendor down there, and it's a bike show because that's where all the bikes will be, and then everyone will be down there and they'll love it." But the cost was like, I think, $150 to maybe $200 to be a part of that show. But the numbers of the previous shows were just outrageous. The number of people there, you were going to make money. It wasn't going to be a big problem. It rained ish. And people didn't want to bring their show bikes out there in the rain. So they were scheduled to have 70 bikes show up. I think 16 showed up. Nobody came down to the bike area to look at no bikes. So I'm standing there with my wife in the rain, drizzle rain. We're not selling anything, and folded up after maybe an hour and a half to two. I was ready to pack it all up, you know, finish the business, all that. But again, ran into Jason that night, and he pulled me back off the ledge. You can't control the weather, but that was my worst night. I think I lost, plus the fee to get in, all the materials and the cost of goods. I must have lost maybe $300, $350 that night just for buying all the goods, stuff I couldn't take back and all that kind of stuff. So that was probably one of the worst nights I had. You know, big, you're excited for a big day and it rains on you and there's nothing you can do about it. Nobody came down to that end. So I was screwed. So that was my worst night. But again, Jason pulled me back up the ledge and back in business. So.
Oh, I mean, you know, I was at the other end of that event, and you know, I think we did, I don't know, 1,200, 1,300. It wasn't great. The rain kept a lot of people away, but this is an event where main section of town, a truck my size, if it was decent weather, $6,000-$7,000.
Right.
I mean, there's that many people. I think Daryl can correct me. I forget. This is like on the 20-something year, I believe.
Yeah. It was. It's the biggest. It's one of the biggest bike shows on the East Coast.
Yeah, it was your 18th year, and I was actually on that committee for years. It was actually deemed the largest single day event, motorcycle event, in the nation by the AMA. Those of you who follow AMA. But in any case, it was a rained event, but it drizzled and so forth. And there was probably a third of the amount of people that showed up. And so it was kind of a tough night for everybody. The sad part is Ed was placed in an area where, quote unquote, the show bikes, the judge bikes, the high end bikes were going to be. And a lot of those trailer queens never showed up with their bikes. So the rest of the place showed up, and you know, it push comes to shove. We happened to be in different areas. To Jason's point, he was on one end of town. Ed was on the other end of town. I was kind of in the middle of the vendors, and you know, made out fairly well. I mean, you know, it was a very profitable night for us. But to both of their point, it is one of the biggest events in the region. You know, come that time of year.
And like real estate, location matters, right? So yeah. You're stuck in a bad spot. I'm down there by the bikes, or quote unquote, the bikes. None of the bikes showed up, and the lady running the show came, and she's like, "I'm really sorry about this." I'm like, you do intend to have motorcycles show up at your motorcycle show, right? It's just what it is. You're not going to take the show bikes out in the rain. And I lost a lot of money that night, and finished the year strong. But that night was the worst night. And like I said, I was on the verge of closing it all down for good. But, you know, you can't control some things like the weather, like your placement. And you just pick and choose and move on, you know.
Well, it's a good attitude, Ed. I appreciate the fact that you'd share it. I'm sure it was a humbling experience.
After doing this for like 5 years, and then you're starting to get bigger and bigger events, and you think, well, that you kind of bank on a couple of them being your big ones every year. And this was my first year doing that, and I overbought. I got, you know, over, you know, 200 lemons over. You know, everything was ready to rock and roll, and it was a bust, you know, a lot of money out the door. And, you know, you get those and you're just like, you know, what am I doing? Why am I doing this? But then you talk to people that, you know, again, what you were talking about, putting limitations on yourself, you know, you talk to Jason, you talk to Daryl, and just keep going. It's one bad night is not going to ruin you, you know. So that's it, right?
I mean, as you saw when you came to see me last week at the ski resort, or a week before, you know, it's raining and we had bare spots on the hill. But the mountain 40 miles west of us, Bear Creek, isn't even open yet. I think they're another week and a half away. So, you know, I think I did, I don't know, $80, $90 that day. We shut down at 1 and I brought the kids home, you know, went out and did stuff with the family. But, you know, like I've, you guys have heard me say before, some days you're the bird, some days you're the windshield. It's going to happen. Right. But you got to do your best to try and, you know, navigate the events. No, you know, there was just somebody in VU tonight talking about a thing that, you know, they want $300. It's a first time food truck rally, and it's a newer vendor. I won't use names because I didn't ask about it first. But me, I'd have to do $3,000 to $3,500 to justify paying Michael $300 for his food truck event. And I told the guy, there's too many red flags, first year event. Nope. What are they doing for me besides posting a couple BS Facebook posts to make it worth $300? Okay. It's got to be worth it. And if you know your numbers, the most you want to do that for is 10%. So if you're looking at it that way, $300 fee means $3,000 to $3,500. Is what you need to generate in sales to make that $300 investment worth it. Other people had chimed in and said things like, oh, you know, I'd pay this for that. Well, if you know your numbers, that's not going to be it. You got to know your numbers inside and out, upside and down. Ask Michael Woods. He can tell you what every glove costs, what every tissue costs. He knows his numbers. Okay. Right. You need to know that because you've heard me say this one too before. I can stay home and not make money. I don't need to go out and lose. Okay. An event like that sounds like a loser. Also, besides the event being a first year, the vendor's a new vendor. So I caution somebody in that situation in a private consult, you don't want to go out and do that. You haven't really vended any big events yet. So you want to go there, put on a bad show, and make a bad impression? No, you're not ready for that. So, you know, I would caution anybody paying for events like that.
Right.
I think I told Daryl too, our first meeting, Daryl, that, you know, for events, I don't usually go over 100, maybe 125, 150 for the charge. This one, I was going out of my range a little bit because the numbers were going to be there. The crowd was going to be there. And then so were the clouds and the rain and all that kind of stuff. So I can understand taking a shot. And I understand what you're saying too about knowing your numbers. And if it's outside your realm, like you just said, I can sit at home and not lose money and come out ahead. So,
yep.
I'd
rather see that new vendor take that 300 and invest it into signs, email marketing, something, you know, something that's going to have a better return. Because here's the other thing. We all know these promoters lie. They're all full of shit. They'll tell you, oh, Daryl, you're the only hot dog guy. And then you get there and there's six of you. And to make it worse, you're all next to each other. They don't even spread you out. And he doesn't care because he made his money when you signed the deal. Okay, he got paid. So he doesn't care if it rains, snows, sleets, 250-degree day. He don't care. He's paid. And you got a hole in your wallet.
Yep. And you got all these dogs and buns and hamburgers and stuff. And
better have a big freezer.
Yep. Yep. So that was my worst day.
Well, thank you for sharing, Ed. Anybody else want to share before we move on? I'd love to hear more. If I know Mark Lawler's got to have a good story. Michael Woods got to have like 10 good stories.
Oh, yeah. I'm going to tell one good story. Let me tell one real quick, Mark. We're always talking about keeping records, and I went back and looked just a second ago. On 10/28/09, my worst day that I can ever remember having, I did $18. But I can tell you every single day I've done since I started. If you don't keep good records, you'll never know when you do bad. You'll never know when you do good. Because, you know, you got to keep up with the records. If for nothing but tax purposes or for whatever reason, for ego, you know, hey, I did great today. You know, I went out and did $1,000 today, and that was a good day, you know. But, or, you know, I had a bad day. That way I don't do what I did that day. But other than that, I'm going to shut up now and let Mark talk. He ain't as pretty as I am, but he talks pretty good.
Yeah, well, it's hard to be as good looking as you. I don't know why my video is not on. So, what? I don't know. Everything's weird here. Can you hear me now?
Yes, sir. Yeah,
let me good check Lord, your there, let there me check go. Your video.
Say what? Yeah, I don't know. It didn't give me the option to turn it on, Ben.
Well, hold on just a second. Let me find you. Mark Lawler, look more. Yep.
I'm down
here we
there.
Go. Let's see. See if your video is now working. Yeah, no. Can't see you yet. Now you're muted. Unmute. Now you're unmuted.
Yeah, I'm unmuted, but you still got my video disabled. But
I don't have it disabled. I got you live, baby. Live.
Can you see me?
I can't see you. That's the thing. But it says that you have permissions for video.
Well, it says you cannot start your video because the host has disabled it. But that's all right. We'll carry on because you got something.
I'm fixing to give you some heck here. Hold on just a second. Let me see if I can find this. Make. Okay. Hold on. Hold on, baby. People got to see you, Mark. You got so much expression in your face. We got to see you.
Oh, here we go. Wait a minute.
Bam. Oh,
holy smoke.
Never mind. Let me turn it off.
That's right. I'm on my phone because my computer died. But anyways, I'm not going to tell you about my worst day because it was not too long ago. And matter of fact, Corey talked me down off top of the house. And I think it was real close to Corey's worst day as well. So there you go. But I tell you what I did learn. For all you folks that are listening that aren't normally in here, what I learned is you can't trust anybody. When you're dealing with event coordinators, if you're dealing with promoters, you can't trust anybody unless it's Jesus and he's standing there making a contract with you and you see the nail holes. You can't trust anybody, so don't do it. I got super screwed in December. I haven't told the story yet, Ben, because we were moving into Christmas, and I wanted to keep it up.
Let's tell the story because it matters, because people need to know that even these, you know, pro vendors and even mediocre vendors like you and Billy and Michael
have trouble too. I'll make a long story as short as I can. So here was the deal. I've got a long-term customer. Been doing bunches of events for them. And it's really events that only will support one vendor. You might could bring in a suite and they might would make a little bit of money, but it's really just enough for one vendor. They were going to have an event and bring in a bunch of food trucks. And I talked to him and said, look, I'm not doing it, but this is a bad idea. And here's why. And laid it all out for him. And of course, nobody made any money at the event. But what happened was, is when the event coordinator went around talking to everybody, guess what all the vendors told him when they said, hey, how'd you do? Guess what all the other vendors said?
What?
Well, we did fine, fine, fine. Everybody did fine. They wouldn't tell them the truth. And I knew the truth because I talked to all of them and asked. And they said, we didn't make $120. And we're talking food trucks now. We're talking Jason Love food trucks, not, you know, something made up. So I booked this event in December. I booked it a year ago, but in October, we got together and said, okay, we're doing the event. So when you have an event already and people call, what do you tell them? I'm already booked. Sorry. And so I turned down about $4,000 or $5,000 worth of work in December to do this event. 2 days before the event starts, 2 days, 48 hours, they put out a call for food trucks at this event. And there's not enough business for food trucks. There's enough business for me. And so now I'm in a pickle because what am I going to do? I've already turned down all my other business for December. And so I slugged it out down there. We were thousands of dollars short. Thousands. Just all because somebody decided it would look good to have a bunch of food trucks around. It would just look good. So I'm also a member of this organization. So in our business meeting here in a couple of weeks, I will be sure when they ask me if I'm coming back. No. I got a hard and fast rule. If me and you are friends and you do something dirty to me, I'm going to forgive you. But in business, when you stick it to me, that's it. We're done. End of story. We are done in business. We can be friends and you can stick it to me and I'm going to forgive you. But in business, when you stick it to me, I am done with you. So I just learned you can't trust anybody. I've known that, but there were a few people I could trust. And now all of those have gone nuts too. So
I'm not on the war path or anything about that. But I think my worst day, Ben, here recently, I think we went out and did $68.
Holy cow.
$68. And so I'm on top of the house getting ready to jump. And Corey WhatsApps me and says, "Hey, how's your day?" I'm like, "I'm fixing to jump off the house."
I said, "Hold on a second. I'll come down with you and jump off too."
Yeah, Corey, because that was pretty close to your worst day as well. So at least
it happens. One of the guys, Paul Browning, was asking about, you know, can you say to a promoter, "Well, you know, I'll pay this." I mean, that's something I told that guy earlier on VU on chat. I said, you know, I'll come back and say, "Well, hey, Michael, if your event's so well publicized and so well attended, I'll give you 10% of gross." And their usual first reaction is, "Oh, I can't do that." Well, what's the matter, Michael? Don't you have faith in your event? It's this and it's that. You do this and that. If it's so great, you might make out more than what you want to charge me.
Yeah.
And if they say no, I tell them, "Well, that's because your event sucks and you suck and piss off."
Yeah, guys, if you don't have your
event, it's that simple. These guys have these grandiose ideas for these fees. They think the trucks and trailers and carts make all this money. And, you know, I've had people say they want 50% of my take. And I tell them, "Yeah, people in hell want ice water. What the hell am I to do? You're not from me. You don't get anything more than 10% from me, because if you know your numbers, you're not going to give anybody anything over 10%.
You're exactly right. And the other thing, guys, somebody watching this and listening to this is going to fall into this trap. You do yourself no favors. There's no such thing as exposure. You get into these events, you need to be willing to say, "This is how I roll. This is how we do it," and be willing to walk away from those events and go do something else. Because if you're just going to, if you're scraping by and you're just going to every kind of event, here's what's going to end up happening. You're going to end up buying too much product. You're going to lose money. You're not going to have enough sales. It's never going to work when you go chasing that stuff. So set your limits and don't get outside those. And if you know what, what Jason just said, a lot of you guys will try that and the promoter will say, "Well, I'm not down with that." And so then you give in and then go do the event anyways. He knows he's got you. So you just have to make a decision and stick with that. And sometimes you're going to have to walk away from events. And once again, events and street food vending, two entirely different animals. And you got to approach them differently. And you got to have a different mindset for both of those.
Well, these promoters, I mean, I signed up for a big one as a music fest. And then a week out, we get told we can't do drinks. Can't get our money back. No problem. I mean, Ben knows this. A couple of other OGs know this. I sold peanuts. So if Mark bought a peanut, he got either a free Diet Coke, or water, his choice. Promoter came over, threw a hissy fit. I said, "I'm not selling drinks. I'm selling peanuts. Look, got some big ones here. Look at this." Called the police. The police came. They said, "The guy's not selling drinks. He's giving drinks away. He's selling peanuts." So you can beat them at their own game, but that – I've said it many times. If a promoter tells me I can't sell drinks, that's a major red flag. That is one of my biggest pet peeves. That means exactly. That the drink sales are all being done by him, and they're going to pocket all the money. And nope, I tell them right to their face.
And we've had some vendors use this in VU after you shared this before. I mean, that's been a couple years ago, and we've had vendors use that. You can count on burning that bridge with that event unless they change coordinators.
I got that vendor to about here. I mean, we're past knuckles. I mean, I had him about here. He didn't like that. So he wanted to stick it to us and we stuck it to him. I mean, you know, the end of the day, I made sure I waved as we drove out.
We got some questions. Anybody got a name for a candy distributor that maybe nationwide that they could, Keith just asked that. A candy distributor. We'll be looking for that. We'll get back to you, Keith.
Watch Facebook group. We'll have it there.
I'd Google it tomorrow. I'd Google it too. Google Facebook. Google it. candy distributor.
Well, one of the guys put up candydirect.com. I haven't worked with them, and I haven't looked at the site, but I know that was in the notes. I think DL put that one up. But again, you can usually do – I find that I would do better with candy at BJ's over Costco. BJ seems to have more of the novelty candies, like the lollipops. There's this new little egg from the people that make Nutella, has like toys in it or something. Those sell like crazy. All that stuff. We get that stuff from there. But you guys can check out that Candy Direct. We'll talk to them. Maybe we can see if we can get a BU deal set up with them. Fruit snacks, like Ed said, fruit snacks, man. We sell the living hell out of that. Also, it's events where you got a lot of kids, whether it be a soccer tournament, ski resort, things like that. If you got a guy in the area that does mini donuts, we sell the hell out of them. I sell them for $8 for a dozen of those mini donuts on a small clamshell. So, that's at the ski resort, but you can do well with those. I have a guy locally that I use for other events, and he'll package them up. And I can pick them up for, I think, $3 a dozen. So, and he does like 5-6 different flavors in that pack. Does like a fruity pebble powder, cinnamon sugar, or some kind of drizzle and something else. So, eye appealing to kids catch them. I mean, the other thing is, any of your gold medal dealers have a lot of different stuff, but I don't know, most of these, we got a lot of new people here, but the cotton candy in the tubs, like the large deli tub, those are great. I can't keep those on the shelf. Diz uses them. I think Ed's using them now. A couple other guys are getting them from any of your gold medal distributors will have that stuff. I believe some people said that Sam's Club had it too. I think you can get it on Sam's Club online and have it delivered to the house. I know Diz uses Sam's Club for a bunch of different stuff and gets it sent to the house. Hey, we're going to give away
free shipping. It's free shipping if you're plus member with Sam's. They'll even ship you chips or whatever you need.
Yeah, and check on Amazon Business account. If you have an Amazon Prime, you can get Amazon Business and go to that portal, which has different options for you, and you can get free shipping. You get an additional 15% off if you subscribe to it, plus another 5%, I believe. So you can get some good deals through Amazon Business or Business for Amazon or Amazon for Business. But if you have a Prime account, you can get a free Amazon Business account, and it's not extra, and it's easy to do. I've got a video and a thing on it as well if you go to learnhotdogs.com. Anthony Kuhn says, if anyone could send me info on catering such as pricing, what to bring, etc. I have a lady who approached me about it, not sure what to tell her. Anthony, here's what I would do. Go to learnhotdogs.com. Unless you're in VU, in VU there's tons of it there, but in learnhotdogs.com, type in the word catering and you will be overwhelmed with the amount of stuff, even step by step on how to do it, how to approach it, how to everything it. I hope that helps you. Next one, has anyone used mycompanyworks.com to set up your LLC? I have not. I've heard of people using, who's that, babe, who's that? That LegalZoom? LegalZoom.com. Yeah. But you can do it yourself. You can also go to Upwork.com and just have somebody do it who's a local attorney, maybe just graduated school. You'll find them on Upwork.com for your state, and they'll do it for you for cheap, $50-$60, and you'll be done. Hope that helps. But I've never heard of My Company Work, so I can't help you there. But let's see. Check this out. Patricia says, for a first-timer with a medium resources for startup, would members of this group consider the lifetime membership to VU a good investment, startup cost, especially considering the price is lower right now? Absolutely not. I would not. I would just do the monthly or the annual and upgrade later. I would not do it now, because let the business buy that later for you. Get in there definitely. $27 a month, y'all. I promise you'll get every penny of your money's worth out of it. But why spend money you have that could be buffer money on, or signage money or good marketing money, that on that, when you can still be in there for less monthly for right now and just wait and let the business buy that. That's my answer for that. Some people.
Hey, Ben.
Yeah.
Let me speak to that just a second, if you don't mind.
All right, go ahead.
And I'm a poster boy for this. I don't know, when I got up with y'all years ago, I had probably been vending full-time for about 6 months, and I found VU and went ahead and jumped on board and said, I'm fixing to piss this money away, but that's okay. I'm just spending money anyways. For you guys that are in here for the first time, let me tell you that $27 a month that you're going to spend on VU, if just by being in the Facebook group and having access to the special secret webpage, you will find things in there that will add so much to your business daily that it will more than pay for itself. I can honestly say, and Ben's not paying me to say this, but I can honestly say that I probably would not be as good or as profitable or as whatever it is I am now if it had not been for VU, because I would have been on those free pages where you get the bad information and you get 4,000 things that may or may not work from people that may or may not be doing this for a living and may or may not be making any damn money. So I can honestly say that VU has been such a resource for my business that I may not be where I'm at now had I not been there. Or I wouldn't have been here as fast, let me put it that way. And I'm a pretty smart fella, but I'm just going to tell you, just having access to this information will take your business to the next level 4 times quicker than other folks.
Well, Mark, while you're here, I appreciate the awesome honesty there. But while you're here, Greg Norris asked, Mark, in a situation like that, would you not be better off trying to educate the organizer and get them to cut back to having you as the only vendor again?
Well, yes, could do that if they had any damn sense.
Other than that.
if you run across either a promoter or an event organizer that will take advice, that's great. Do that. Unfortunately, most of them are going to be dumb as a bag of hammers. And they've made these decisions based off of erroneous ideas that they have. And it's always people that are not in this business that think they know the best way to do everything. You know, this was a case where somebody just thought it would look good for them to have 4 food trucks and a suite out there. And it does look good, but it don't help the people that are in business out. So I try talking to them, but after you've done this for a while, you can tell who the idiots are, and you might as well just be beating your head on I just ain't got time to waste with them. I just walk off. But yeah, if you've got somebody that's got good sense, give it a shot. But no, they're usually too stupid to take good advice. That's why they're in the situation to start with. That's all I got to say about that.
Well, appreciate it.
That's the long and the short of it.
All right. Let's see. We got another one. I went on VU first time out. As I heard all the great info, did a lifetime member out the door. Kind of wasn't doing any other. Okay. I'm going to answer that. Billy says, I went all in on VU first time out as I heard all the great info there and knew it would be invaluable. Did the lifetime membership out the door and constant learning. Wouldn't do any other way if you can afford it. Thanks for that, Billy. I appreciate it. I think we already run over. So let's give away a cart. What do y'all say? I don't know if y'all want to do that yet.
That's right. Give it away.
Let's do it.
Give it away.
All right. So here's how we're going to do this. We're going to do it like last year. I think we decided.
Go make it randomize the numbers here.
Randomize the numbers, but let 3 people pick a number. Is how we did it. And this time, I promise you, I have a real fresh list. So that, I remember last year we gave it away to somebody and it wasn't even on the list.
Wasn't in the group anymore. Yeah.
Okay, so here's the deal. You got all the way, Here's the deal, 412. Okay, so we got 412 digits. So you could be 001 all the way to 412. Now, they randomized the list twice today for me because the first time it still pulled out, it like randomized it, but it sorted it by email address alphabetically. It was the stupidest thing. So I sent it back to them and said, randomize the list, full random, get rid of all the other stuff. And so they took out the parameters, and so I have a randomized list. And if we get three people to pick a number, and then that number will be the winner. It can be 001, or it can be all the way up to 412.
All right, so to make things easier, I'm going to have our panelists that are cleared to talk do the picking, just so I don't have to go through trying to bring people in since we did this broadcast this way, all right?
Okay.
So I'll ask Ed, Keith, and Michael to give me numbers. How's that?
Ed,
Michael,
Keith, and Michael.
Without taking your shoes off, can you just do it with your hands, Michael? Is that all right?
Who's first?
All right, Michael, will you give me the first number, please?
Who?
Michael Wood.
Oh, okay.
You can
the
do
first it. Number is two.
Okay. Two.
Okay. Just remember, each number, depending, like we get, well, it depends on what the first two numbers are, what the last sequence of numbers can be. Like the first number can only be 0 through 4. So.
All right. So, Ed, can you give me the second number, please? Ed Forbes, second number.
Muted.
Ed, what is it?
Eight.
Eight. Got it. All right, Mark, can you give me the third number, please, sir?
So I know it. I know it's going to be in the 280s. So
what's my range here?
You can do anything you want, 0 to 9.
Yep.
5.
285. Hold on. 285. Ken Packer. Holy moly, Ken Packer. He's our.
Oh, I know you.
I know Ken Packer.
He's kind of new to vending.
He's brand new at vending.
Yeah.
Ken Packer, 285. Let me write this down on something.
Congratulations, Ken.
285, Ken Packer. And congratulations, Ken. You want a fully loaded, if you didn't already know what we were giving away, a fully loaded, however you want it, cash cow, double steam table, flip top, grill, whatever you want. Okay? And I may even deliver that to you because I know where you is. You're up there near Virginia. So Ken Packer, is he even in here tonight?
Yeah,
he said, I think he's in here. Yeah, he's in here tonight.
Yeah, he's in there. He said, are you kidding?
Yeah, he is in here. I show him in here twice.
Yep, he's in there. Hey guys, I gotta go. I gotta go pick up one of my kids at school. Congratulations, Ken. Everybody else, happy new year. Make lots of money.
Yeah.
Michael, you might actually work 8 hours this month. Michael's going to do some more hours. 19. So, happy new year to everybody. Congratulations, Ken.
Yeah, congratulations. We'll see y'all all next Monday night, Vendors United Private Group. And love you. Hope you got a lot from this. And always know you can go to learnhotdogs.com and get a ton of help for free. Okay,
peace. We got tons.
See y'all later.